Welcome to Learning English, a daily 30-minute program from the Voice of America. I'm Ashley Thompson.
And I'm Dan Novak. This program is designed for English learners, so we speak a little slower, and we use words and phrases especially written for people learning English. Coming up on the program, today, Americans observe Memorial Day. Mario Ritter Jr. and Caty Weaver tell us about Memorial Day traditions and explain the meaning of the holiday. Bryan Lynn has the science report on a rocket that could greatly reduce space travel times. Later, Jill and Andrew Smith present the lesson of the day. But first,
Memorial Day is a national holiday observed in the United States on the last Monday in May. This year, Memorial Day falls on May 27th. It is a day when Americans honor the men and women who have died fighting in America's wars. For most Americans, it also marks the unofficial start of summer. It is a popular weekend for vacationing.
Memorial Day traditions include the observance at Arlington National Cemetery. It is the most famous burial place in America. The tradition began on May 30, 1868, when flowers were placed on the graves of Union and Confederate soldiers in the cemetery. It was called Decoration Day back then. Since 1948, on the Thursday before Memorial Day, soldiers from the 3rd U.S. Infantry, the Old Guard, have placed small American flags in front of every headstone in the cemetery. Lines of simple white headstones mark the soldiers' graves. But the 80-hectare cemetery also serves as a burial place for people of national and historical importance. Two presidents are buried there, William Howard Taft and John F. Kennedy. Other well-known people buried at the cemetery include world champion boxer Joe Louis, North Pole explorer Robert E. Peary, and the seven astronauts who died in the Space Shuttle Challenger explosion. Nearly 4,000 former slaves are also buried at Arlington National Cemetery. One of them is James Parks. He dug the first graves in the cemetery.
The best-known memorial in the nation's capital, however, is the Vietnam Veterans Memorial, which opened in 1982. In 1980, a group of former soldiers announced a competition to design a memorial. The winner was Maya Lin, a 21-year-old student at Yale University in New Haven, Connecticut. Lin designed a memorial formed by two walls of black stone, about 76 meters long. The walls meet to form a V. The names of more than 58,000 Americans killed or declared missing in action are cut into the stone. Almost any time of day, you can see people looking for the name of a family member or friend who died in the war. Once they find the name, many rub a pencil on paper over the letters to copy it. Many people leave remembrances at the Vietnam Veterans Memorial. After the success of the Vietnam Veterans Memorial, Congress approved a memorial to the Korean War veterans, which opened in July of 1995. The Korean War lasted from 1950 to 1953. The memorial honors those who died. It also honors those who survived.
One of the lesser-known memorials on the National Mall in Washington, D.C., is often called the Temple. The round stone structure honors people from the District of Columbia who died in World War I. The war was fought from 1914 to 1918. Between the Lincoln Memorial and the Washington Monument on the National Mall is the World War II Memorial. The U.S. entered the war after Japan bombed the Navy base at Pearl Harbor, Hawaii, on December 7th, 1941. 16 million men and women served in the American military between 1941 and 1945. More than 400,000 died. The World War II Memorial is built of bronze and granite. In the center, at ground level, is a round pool of water. When the sun is just right, rainbows of color dance in the air. 56 stone pillars rise around the pool. They represent each of the American states and territories, plus the District of Columbia, at the time of the war. There are not yet memorials for soldiers who died in America's most recent wars, in Iraq and Afghanistan. The soldiers are buried in Section 60 of Arlington Cemetery. The section is often called the saddest place in America. On Memorial Day, Americans are called to stop for 1 minute at 3 o'clock local time for the National Moment of Remembrance, to honor the soldiers who have died in service to the country, no matter what wars they served in. I'm Caty Weaver.
And I'm Mario Ritter, Jr.
Private company is working with the American Space Agency, NASA, to develop a new rocket that could greatly reduce space travel times. The engine for such a rocket will be designed to sharply increase the amount of thrust to speed up space travel and improve rocket efficiency. Thrust is the force that pushes a spacecraft through the air. It is produced by a propulsion system. Generally, a gas or liquid fuel is burned to produce thrust from the back of a spacecraft to propel it forward at high speed. The new design, called Pulsed Plasma Rocket, PPR, is being developed by Arizona-based company Howe Industries. The company is currently in the early stages of studying the technology before building working engine models. In a recent statement, Howe Industries said such rocket technology will be needed to support NASA's plans to return humans to the moon and after that, possibly Mars. The space agency has also set a goal to build a long-term base in space. But one barrier to all these plans is the long travel times necessary with current spacecraft systems. NASA estimates the moon sits an average of about 382,500 kilometers from Earth. The exact distance changes because of the moon's orbit around Earth. The average distance from Earth to Mars is 225 million kilometers. NASA says a trip to Mars with existing spacecraft would take at least 200 days each way. Developers of the proposed pulsed plasma rocket have said it could reduce travel time to the Red Planet to about 2 months each way. Howe Industries said its new design gives the rocket the ability to reach extremely high speeds to complete reasonable space travel times. The development team estimates its PPR system could produce up to 100,000 N of thrust. The N at the end of the number stands for newtons, a unit of measurement for thrust. NASA has described its Space Launch System, SLS, as the most powerful ever built. The agency has said the SLS rocket system is expected to provide nearly 53N of thrust during space travel. Developers of PPR say that in addition to a huge increase in thrust, the new design also provides a specific impulse rate of 5,000. Specific impulse is a method for measuring, in seconds, thrust and efficiency levels of rocket engines. The higher this rate is, the more efficient the rocket system is. By comparison, the SLS rocket has specific impulse rates below 500. Officials at Howe have said the PPR is based on another plasma-based technology known as pulsed fission fusion. NASA says this process involves quickly pressing plasmas into high pressures to produce thrust. But the developers say the PPR system is smaller, simpler, and costs less to operate. Howe's statement introducing the technology said the combination of extremely high thrust and higher specific impulse rate holds the potential to revolutionize space exploration. The team said such a system should be able to propel much heavier spacecraft and support much longer trips to more distant areas of space. The planned system could also make it easier for spacecraft to be equipped with heavy shields to protect traveling astronauts from galactic cosmic rays. These are highly energetic particles that move through space at nearly the speed of light. The rays can be harmful to humans in large amounts. The PPR project is one in a series of NASA development projects that recently received additional financial assistance to keep running. The projects are part of a NASA program called Innovative Advanced Concepts, or NIAC. PPR is currently in Phase 1 of development. The team said if chosen by NASA to continue with Phase 2, it will be centered on improving the performance of the proposed engine, as well as carrying out experiments on major engine systems. The last phase will involve completing a spaceship design for carrying humans to Mars. I'm Bryan Lynn.
Bryan Lynn joins me now to talk more about his science report. Thanks again for joining me, Bryan.
Sure, Dan. Glad to be here.
This week, you reported on a new rocket system being developed for NASA that could greatly reduce travel time for future space missions. How far along is this research so far?
So, at this point, the research is still in the early stages of development. What the team has been doing so far is using computer software to create a model of a fully operational pulsed plasma rocket. This is a very common method for creating early concepts and designs of these kinds of systems. And the developers say that in this case, the goal of the modeling process is to get a good idea, in theory, whether this proposed rocket will work as planned, and as well whether the necessary materials and power systems are currently available to build such a rocket.
Are there other research efforts happening based on this same rocket technology?
Yes, actually there are several other research groups working on the development of this technology, specifically using plasma-based systems to provide greater thrust for space rockets. Some of these are international groups. Studies related to the technology have been published in recent years by scientists in Japan, Britain, France, and other places. As our report mentions, research on the PPR system is being supported by NASA, but several other U.S. government agencies, including the Department of Energy, are also working to develop this technology.
All right. Thanks again for joining me, Bryan.
You're welcome. Thank you, Dan.
VOA Learning English has launched a new program for children. It is called Let's Learn English with Anna. The new course aims to teach children American English through asking and answering questions and experiencing fun situations. For more information, visit our website, learningenglish.voanews.com.
Mateo.
My name is Andrew Smith.
And my name is Jill Robbins. You're listening to the lesson of the day on the Learning English podcast. Welcome to the part of the show where we help you do more with our series, Let's Learn English. This series shows Anna Mateo in her work and life in Washington, D.C.
In another lesson of the day, we started to look at Lesson 37 of the series. In Lesson 37, Anna starts talking to a man who is visiting Washington, D.C. The man lives in a rural area and does not feel comfortable in the city. Soon, Anna and the man start talking about whether they prefer to live in the city or the country.
And in this situation, the word country just means a rural area. Let's listen to their conversation.
Thank you. Thank you.
Are you okay? You seem nervous.
Well, this is my first visit to Washington, D.C. I'm from a small town in the country. I feel a little lost.
I'm from the country, too. And I understand. When I first came here, I felt lost. All the time.
So, do you like living in the country or in the city?
I like to live in the city.
Why?
The city is exciting. It has more culture than the country. There are many museums and restaurants. Every night, there's theater and music. And there are more jobs. That is why I'm here.
Well, I agree. There is more culture in the city, and there might be more jobs, but the country has more nature. It's peaceful and beautiful. There are more trees and mountains. The air is clean. You can go hiking and camping. The city is not beautiful. It's noisy and dirty.
I disagree. I think all the different buildings are beautiful. And I like to watch all the different people.
That's another thing that is different. People in the country are friendly. They always say hello. Here, no one says hello. I think city people are rude.
Well, I agree. Country people are friendly. But I don't think city people are rude. I think they're just busy.
That's a good point.
Anna and the man disagree because they have different preferences, which means things they prefer or like more.
And I think it's important to notice that even though they disagree about some things, they are not really arguing or fighting about their preferences.
True. They are not being disagreeable.
Disagreeable is an adjective we can use to describe people behaving in a negative or rude way.
Unpleasant is another adjective we can use to describe this.
Like, we can say that a way in which a person is talking is disagreeable or unpleasant.
And with Anna and the man, we can say that they are acting agreeably.
We know that might sound strange to our listeners. Anna and the man disagree, but they are acting agreeably. That means they are speaking nicely to each other.
That's right. Just like the adjective disagreeable, the adjective agreeable can describe a person.
If someone is agreeable, they are pleasant and try to please other people.
So, listeners, see if you understand this sentence. They are agreeably disagreeing.
That means they are disagreeing in a nice way.
Remember, it's fine to disagree. There's no problem with that. But try not to be disagreeable when you disagree.
I'm Jill Robbins, and you're listening to the lesson of the day on the Learning English Podcast. In their conversation, Anna and the man do agree about some things.
That's right. They do find some common ground. They agree that there are more jobs in the city and that people from the country are friendly.
To find common ground means to find things that you agree about, even when you disagree about other things. Now let's listen to the rest of Lesson 37 and find out what else they might agree on.
Well, I agree. Country people are friendly. But I don't think city people are rude. I think they're just busy.
That's a good point.
Look at me. I live in the city, and I said hello to you.
But you are from the country.
I have an idea. let's say hello to people. To many people.
What? Why?
Well, if we say hello, then they will say hello to other people. Hello?
And they will say hello to more people. That's a great idea. I'm glad you found my bag.
Come on, let's go say hello to people. We don't have to agree with people. They have their opinions, we have ours. And as we like to say, you can always agree to disagree. Until next time, hello.
In the city, saying hello to all the people who walk past you on the street is not normal behavior.
But then again, Anna does not always behave normally.
No, she doesn't. When Anna and the man go up to lots of people in the city and say hello, they are breaking a cultural norm.
As you can hear, the word norm sounds similar to the word normal. A cultural norm is a behavior, attitude, or belief that is commonly shared within a certain culture.
For example, in the United States, it is a cultural norm to apologize if you are late for a meeting. Another cultural norm is for men and women to shake hands when they meet at a business meeting.
We can say that people break cultural norms when they show behaviors, attitudes, or beliefs not commonly shared within a culture.
And we use the verb adhere, spelled A-D-H-E-R-E, plus the preposition to talk about following the usual or normal behaviors within a culture.
For example, we might say in an important business or government meeting, people usually adhere to cultural norms.
In a physical sense, the verb adhere means to stick to something. For example, glue adheres to most surfaces.
Social norms means the same thing as cultural norms.
That's a good point. Now, let's review some of the vocabulary from today's lesson of the day.
We have the adjectives agreeable and disagreeable to describe either good or bad behaviors or conditions.
And we have the adverb form of those words, agreeably and disagreeably.
And we have the words pleasant and unpleasant, which also describe good and bad.
Then there's the expression, find common ground.
And next we talk about cultural or social norms and the expressions break cultural norms and adhere to cultural norms.
Now, here's something for our listeners to do. Write to us and tell us what you think is an important cultural norm in your own culture. We might discuss what you tell us in a future lesson of the day.
And you can email that to learningenglish@voanews.com. Remember, you can find us on Facebook, YouTube, and Instagram. You can also find all the episodes of Let's Learn English on our website at learningenglish.voanews.com. And thanks for listening. I'm Dr. Jill.
And I'm Andrew Smith.
That's our program for today. Join us again tomorrow to keep learning English through stories from around the world. I'm Ashley Thompson.
And I'm Dan Novak.